So hello, everyone, as you get settled in to this virtual space of worship. I am the Reverend Lora Young, and my pronouns are she and her. Welcome, welcome, welcome to our online service this morning. Tina is our tech host this morning, and she will be recording our service and posting it to YouTube later today. At this point, most of us are familiar with the Zoom interface, but if you are new to South Valley, here are some ways that we like to gather together in the online space. In the corner of your screen, your display name acts as a virtual name tag for you. And we encourage you to change your name as needed and add your preferred pronouns. We very much want to greet you in the way that you feel most comfortable, and this helps us to do that. Everyone is muted during the service. At times, we will invite you to be unmuted and participate in unison readings and singing. You can participate in the way that you feel most comfortable. And of course, it is always up to you as to how you wish to view the service. You can toggle back and forth between the speaker view, which allows you to focus on the person who is singing or speaking at a given time, or you can enjoy the gallery where you can see all of us gathered together in community. Finally, we are going to be using the chat box throughout the service. If you have questions about how to use the chat box, please wave your hand right now and David will come over and help you figure out how to open and close that. Our Zoom runner, Tina, is now going to begin our recording. Let us worship.
People get ready, there's a train a-coming. You don't need no baggage, you just get on board. All you need is faith to hear the diesel humming. You don't need no ticket, you just thank the Lord. So people get ready, the train to Jordan, picking up passengers coast to coast. Faith is the key, open doors and borders, hope for us all among the love that mourns. So people get ready, there's a train a-coming. You don't need no baggage, you just get on board. All you need is faith to hear the diesel humming. You don't need no ticket, you just thank the Lord. Ain't no room for the hopeless sinner, hurt all mankind just to save his own. Have plenty on those whose chances grow thinner. There's no hiding place against the kingdom's throne. So people get ready, there's a train a-coming. You don't need no baggage, you just get on board. All you need is faith to hear the diesel humming. You don't need no ticket, you just thank the Lord. You don't need no ticket, you just to thank the
Good morning. I'm Ewing Kobanka, and I'm a member of the Board of Trustees here at South Valley Unitarian Universalist Society. My pronouns are he and him. Come, whoever you are welcome here. No matter your age, your size, the color of your eyes, your hair, your skin, you are welcome here. No matter your gender, whom you love, how you speak, or whatever your abilities, you are welcome here. You're welcome here whether you come with laughter in your heart or tears in your eyes, you are welcome here. No matter what you have experienced in the past, no matter what awaits you in the future, you are welcome here. Whether you believe in God all of the time or some of the time or none of the time, you are welcome here. This is a community of open minds, loving hearts, and willing hands. You are welcome here at South Valley Unitarian Universalist Society.
I invite you now to settle a little deeper into your space as we call out collectively into the space of worship and notice that this ground is already holy and yet intrinsically made more holy by our presence together. We live in uncertain times right now, and it would be remiss of me as your minister to not continue to hold space for those that are struggling in the midst of this pandemic. As of yesterday, the United States saw over 166,000 deaths from COVID-19. We stand in solidarity with voices that are seeking justice, that are seeking universal care, and we weep with those who have lost those close and dear to them. Let us not forget that we are all connected in the midst of this time of physical distancing. Our call to worship was written by Cass Adams, and it goes like this. I gaze quietly into the depths of a forest and see nothing save beauty and peace. Birdsong fills my ears. A gentle breeze brushes against my cheek. Seeing from the inside seeing, I drink the dark riches of the woods. Oh, would it be that every day I could see my own face so clearly in these still waters and meet the emptiness, which is also my very own heart that is carried in the boughs of pines and in the gentle music of crickets. Let us worship with our hearts wide open this morning. We're going to be singing our first hymn in a moment, and Travis will be leading us. And we're going to be adopting a practice that I have observed some of our other sister congregations using in this interim time of physical distancing. Some of our sister congregations have been using an in-gathering hymn that changes just once per month as a way of creating continuity between these online spaces. So I'd like us to try this for a few weeks and see how it goes. For August, we're going to be singing the very familiar hymn to South Valley, Come Sing a Song with Me. And Travis is going to be leading us on his guitar.
Just a reminder, the lyrics will be in the chat box, I think.
Come sing a song with me. Come sing a song with me. Come sing a song with me. I may know your mind. Come dream a dream with me. Come hope is hard to find. I'll bring a song of love in the rose in the winter time. Come share a rose with me. Come share a rose with me. Come share a rose with me. I may know your mind. I'll bring you home when hope is hard to find. I'll bring a song of love and a rose in the winter time. I'll bring you home when hope is hard to find. I'll bring a song of love and a rose.
Thank you, Travis, and everyone for singing along at home. Now we will light our chalices. If you have one at home and you'd like to do this along together, the chalice lighting words are in your chat box. And we will light these. We will unmute you to say the words together. And as you know, we have lots of motions for our chalice lighting at South Valley. So stand if you want to. Do these together, okay.
Okay.
Well, unmute us. Okay. Here we go. Light this chalice for the word
of love,
for the light of truth,
and the energy of action.
Excellent. Okay.
Welcome, everyone. We are South Valley, an intentionally diverse religious community, and all are welcome here. We want to extend an especially warm welcome to any newcomers and visitors who found us online, and we're so glad you have. David has just dropped the connection card in the chat box, and it's a way for you to connect with us if you'd like to. Fill that out. We'd love to get to know you. This is a caring, supportive community, and during this time of physical distancing, we're working to be creative in how we take care of each other. So David will also drop a pastoral care card now in the chat box. And that's a way for you to let us know if there is some way that you'd like the minister or our caring committee to reach out to you during. All of our online services are meant to be intergenerational, and Rebecca is soon going to be doing a wonderful story that will pull us together in the intergen aspect. And then our religious education gatherings for children and youth are taking place separately most weeks. So if you want to find out more about those, please look in the Happenings newsletter or contact Rebecca Britt. And she probably is waving somewhere on the gallery view, and you will see her with the story in a minute. Her email will be put in the chat box as well. Thank you, David, for putting all this information there. To keep updated on all the activities at South Valley, we do encourage you to use the Google Calendar that's on our website. We are still connected. We have a knitting group that gets together, a caring group that makes things for those who could use a warm shawl in a time of need, and many other creative kinds of groups are getting together still. Book groups, all of it happening online. So please look for those and join those. We do have an announcement, and it will be put up at the end of the service on an announcement page as well. But next Sunday, August 23rd, 2:30 to 3:30, we have an opportunity to have some fun and come decorate your car, decorate yourself. Come wave and honk and say hello to Reverend Lora and Rebecca. And if you want to bring water for our annual water ceremony, you can drop it off then. If you want to bring a backpack because you're going back to school, it can be blessed during that time as well. So hopefully everyone comes and joins in August 23rd, 2:30 to 3:30 in front of the church. And there's information and happenings and an announcement at the end of service will appear as well. Now we're going to unmute one more time, everybody, and say hello. And write in the chat box where you're saying hello from if you want to, and it'll just be all chaotic and it'll be fun for just a minute, and then we'll have the story.
No.
Hello, everybody. So good to speak with you all.
Hi,
you this week.
Hi.
Great.
So, it's fun to see you here.
Hi, everyone.
Hello, everyone. Yes. It's good to see you.
Oh, good to see everyone.
Welcome, Reverend Lora.
Hi, everyone.
Hi, Tara's here.
Casey, Derek.
Hi, Anne. Reverend Lora has friends and family here, too. Yay.
Ooh, where?
Oh, from all over. They're sneaking in.
The beauty of Zoom.
I'll say Southern California.
The beauty of Zoom. We can all be here. Minneapolis is here.
Hi, pretty good.
I'm still looking for red hair.
I know. So the movements made ourselves.
Hey, let's hear the story.
Hi.
Hello, everyone. My name is Rebecca Britt. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. I am the Director of Religious Exploration. Like Brenda said, if you want to get involved in our classes, please email me. So I have a story to share with you, but I have to admit I didn't write it on my own. I had some friends helping me out. Porpoise and Fish want to go on an adventure, and so we decided to make a story about it. So this is called The Better Adventure, and it's by Porpoise and Fish and me for today's service. As time has gone on, Porpoise and Fish have gotten more and more comfortable exploring the world. They took a trip to Crestwood Park in Cottonwood Heights to explore. "I want to go somewhere I've never been before," Porpoise said. Fish paused. He was trying to be more supportive. He decided to say, "Well, that's basically everywhere. Of course, I'm the better explorer. Fishes are extra good explorers." As they came down the dirt and gravel road, Porpoise said, "I think we're both pretty good explorers." When they reached a fork in the road, they considered which way to go. Porpoise looked to the east. He saw a shady road that was safe from the bright setting sun. It reminded them of the shady coves they used to swim in. But they couldn't see the end of the road. There was no telling where it would end. They decided that was the most adventurous way to go because it required the most bravery. Fish swam a bit down the west road and saw that the sun was bright and there were cliffs and mountains. It was easy to see the road ahead, but he'd never explored anywhere quite so bright. He decided that this was the most adventurous way to go because it required the most bravery. And we're seeing Fish and Porpoise on the dirt road. Fish said, "We need to go west. It's like a big rocky desert, and we'll find gold and gems." Porpoise said, "East is where the adventure is. It's dark and twisty, and we'll find dragons for sure." They were both very sure that theirs was the right way to go, with the most adventure. So they decided to go their separate ways and turn back at sunrise and meet here again. They were each sure that the road they were taking had the best adventure. Porpoise headed down the eastern road. They encountered danger and adventure. At one point, the road was covered with very small apples that needed a home. There were lots of extra paths that went down to a creek. Porpoise wasn't expecting more forks in the road. They decided to stay on their path. They were surprised that even though they chose a shady path, Sun reached through, and soon they reached a clearing. On the other side of the park, Fish was in the hot sun, walking past dry plants and the occasional dog. He couldn't believe how big the mountains were in the distance. Out of the corner of his eye, he saw a tall, moving, dark tower that seemed to follow him around. It was very curious. But Fish was surprised to see that he was coming towards a wooded area with trees he couldn't see past. Why would his path be changing? Fish came to a wide open clearing right before the woods, just like the ones Porpoise went to. He couldn't believe his path had changed. Somewhere, probably very far away, Porpoise left the wooded area and came to a spot right before a sunny path beside a cliff. They couldn't believe that their adventure was over. Fish needed a rest. Somewhere, probably very far away, Porpoise needed a rest too. Fish stopped at the base of the tree, and Porpoise climbed in a low spot in a tree that was probably very, very far away. They'd gone to different roads after all. They both sighed. Oh! What are you doing here? Porpoise asked. This is where my path ends, said Fish. What are you doing here? They've looked and seen each other. They were by the same tree. Mine too, Porpoise said. Each of them looked at the path they've traveled and the path ahead. I think I know what happened, Porpoise said. We walked the same path. We just took different ways to get here. And here we have a picture of Crestwood Park. There it's in a big loop that's shaped like, I don't know, some kind of country. And so we see that Fish took a trip along the northern or the western edge. And then he stopped at a place in the middle of it. And Porpoise took a different trip, but they still stopped the same place. It's a big long loop. The friends decided to continue on their paths. Now confident that even if they traveled the rest of their journey alone, they would still meet up and continue the rest of their journeys together, and they'd have the same path to talk about. The end.
Thank you, Rebecca. It's always good to see Porpoise and Fish. It is our practice at South Valley to share our Sunday worship offerings with a charitable organization that aligns with our principles and values. For July and August, we are sharing our offering with Black Lives Matter Utah, a local group that has been working diligently to stop police brutality. They are fighting for police accountability and transparency and are pushing for community-controlled civilian police review boards and police reforms. The Salt Lake Area branch has asked that our contribution go to the Northern Utah branch in Ogden. At South Valley, we use Givelify as an app for our giving. This allows us to continue at South Valley to receive funds during this pandemic. You're invited to give using the link that David is going to put into the chat box. Or you can go to your phone and download the app. Using this app will help South Valley tremendously during this time of physical distance. Thank you. David is now going to put our offering words into the chat box and let us read these words together. We are this church. We are its hands, its heart, its voice. Together we share the wealth of this community and sustain it with our gifts.
Thank you.
We were born before the wind, all so younger than the sun. And the bonnie boat was won as we sailed into the state. Smell the sea, feel the sky. Let your soul and spirit fly into the mystic. When that foghorn whistle blows, know I will be coming home. When that foghorn whistle blows, wanna hear it, don't have to fear it now. On a rock and roll gypsy soul, just like way back in the days of old. Together we will flow into the mystic. When that foghorn whistle blows, you know I will be coming home. When that foghorn whistle blows, I gotta hear it, don't have to fear it now. I wanna rock your gypsy soul, just like way back in. Together we will flow into the mystic.
For all that we have received and all we have found the courage to give, may we be truly thankful. May these gifts be a blessing to South Valley and Black Lives Matter, Utah. I invite you now to enter into a time of silent meditation, reflection, and prayer.
Not Taken by Robert Frost. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth, and then took the other as just as fair and having perhaps the better claim because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had worn them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day. Yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. So ends our reading for today.
So when I was in my early 30s, I decided that I could best serve the world by training to become a life coach. I'd been on a long path of self-inquiry and reflection, and I was going a little stir crazy at home with my young children. So I signed up for classes, and in a few months, I launched my private practice. It was early in 2008, the start of what we now call the Great Recession. At the time, though, I was not at all concerned about it, for I had a clear vision and a 10-point plan, and I was completely certain of my direction. And I expected the universe to manifest according to my desires. I thought that my path looked like this. And what you see here is a long, clear path. There's no debris in the road. The skies are clear and it's a sunny day, probably fall. I learned a lot in the next 2.5 years. I worked hard to launch my practice, but none of it was lessons that I particularly wanted to learn. So in early 2011, I admitted that despite my best efforts and all of my hard work, that things were not going as I had planned. I was so mad at God, really quite in a bunch about the whole thing. And it wasn't the first time, nor the last time, that the sacred and I have had a bit of a disagreement. I learned, though, in that encounter, that in my case at least, the path looks a little bit more like this. I'm not in charge of the path, I realized. I can choose how to be on the path and who I am walking with and all of that, but whether or not the path is curvy or hilly or double backs on itself or well lit, not so much. And I keep having to learn that same lesson over and over again. In early 2016, in the midst of seminary and a unit of clinical pastoral education, my husband and I decided to separate after nearly 21 years together. It was a heart-rending time. And by the end of that year, I found that I had filed for divorce, sold our family home, gotten an apartment, and was in the beginning stages of coming out as bisexual to my family and friends. By the end of the next year, I had completed seminary and internship, was delighted to be falling in love, and was aiming my sights towards hospital chaplaincy. And yet, despite all that I had learned about not being in charge of the path, I was still surprised in late 2018 when I found myself turning down an offer at my local hospital for a full-time chaplaincy role. And I was surprised when I entered the search process shortly thereafter that I was not selected for a parish role by any of the congregations I had applied or interviewed with. And you'd think that I would have been irreparably slumped. But I wasn't, and I'm not. Because I'm learning that a twist or a turn or double back in the road is not evidence that I have fallen off the path, but rather that I am still on it. And that awareness of the nature of the path, applies very much to this moment, the beginning of our partnership as a minister and congregation, a beginning that we will forge in the midst of a global pandemic and a time of economic and social uncertainty that, to use the word unprecedented, seems so 2016. What we need now, in this moment, is to remember that while effort is required, perfectionism will only make us miserable. And that while storytelling is essential, crafting a fantasy about what is or could be is just as foolish as telling ourselves in hindsight that we picked the better path. Truly, when we are at those forks in the road, we sweat BBs, don't we? We don't know which way is the right way to go. And ultimately, we just choose a path and we hope for the best. And we work hard to learn as much as we can along the way. And that's similar to the messaging that Brené Brown talks about. She's the guru of vulnerability, as many of you know. And she frames this engagement with the decisions that we make, this engagement with vulnerability, as a practice of building resiliency and courage, a practice of rising strong, to borrow directly from the title of her book on that topic. I spent a lot of time listening to Brené Brown and what she had to say about the power of vulnerability in 2016 and 2017. And it got me through. What kept me on track and intact more than anything else has been my at times begrudging willingness to surrender my ego, to get clear on my path, and to live into those values with integrity, especially when doing so is uncomfortable or inconvenient. And lest you think that that's always a graceful transition, let me assure you that I too am very human in my transition. I struggle and I wail and I pule and I moan, and then I finally get going along. But that sense of being able to be intentionally engaged with one another and with the work that confronts us is a piece that I would like to bring to my time with you here at South Valley. A practice of surrender, of discernment, of an intentionally engaging our vulnerability so that we can live into our collective values as Unitarian Universalists, values of love and justice. Even when it takes longer than we expected, it's uncomfortable, inconvenient, or uncertain. Last March, when COVID-19 began taking the lives of thousands of people daily, it was radically necessary to slow down, to pay attention, to focus on the essential, and just keep breathing while it seemed the world rocked and rolled around us. And at that time, our vision for the future naturally shortened. And this crisis is not over yet, not by a long shot, but we are, I think, acclimating and adjusting. And I see much to be hopeful for in the midst. For one, we are able to be together in this space. And two, we are at the start of a new ministry. This is a special moment in the life of a congregation, not because I am some superhuman capable of solving all of your problems, but because together we take seriously the life and the purpose of this congregation. And we're choosing to show up for each other in the midst with joy, with courage, and with a conviction that the ground we stand on is holy and the life we share is worthy of love and our attention. So a few of you have asked over the last few weeks what my vision for South Valley might entail. And the truth is, I haven't a clue, because I really don't know you that well yet. For me to suggest a vision at this point would be to imagine that as a new minister, I somehow have the path to invoke a way forward that resembles that first picture that I showed you. When in reality, life is much more like that curvy, treacherous road in the second picture. I don't yet know your stories, your history, your hopes, and your dreams. But I do know that we are on a journey together, and that both the journey and the destination are important. The journey is the collection of moments that we are growing in compassion, we're deepening our joy and engaging with our limitations and our shortcomings. The journey is how we become human. The destination is arrival to a place where we know ourselves individually and collectively to be full of worth and dignity. As an individual, arrival is awareness that we are already enough. And as a congregation, arrival is the presence of connectedness, commitment to service, and deep compassion for the whole. It is the consistent creation of brave spaces where spiritual transformation is not just possible, but probable. And arrival as a congregation is the ability of South Valley to express its unique and life-saving message of hope in the Great Salt Lake area. I used to think that embarking on a journey meant being perfect along the way. And I would spend endless hours packing and repacking my proverbial and actual backpacks, envisioning every outcome, taking way too much along. And now I am learning that traveling light, keeping close to my companions, and being open to the adventure are as essential to the journey as good planning, especially when the road leads you away from where you thought you were going. So let's pack light and stay close to one another. And together we will see what the road ahead brings. It is a joy to be beginning this journey with you. And I am glad to have arrived here. May you be well, may I be well, may we be well, and may the whole be well. Amen.
We will now extinguish our chalice together, and you're invited to stand and say those words together as David puts them into the chalice, into the chat box. We extinguish this chalice, but not the warmth of community, the light of truth, or the energy of action. We hold each other in our hearts until we meet again.
Our time of worship is now coming to a close, but our togetherness remains. I invite you as you go forth in this week to notice the edges of your vulnerability and to remember that you are connected in ways big and small to those that are around you and to this community of South Valley. Go forth now and be a blessing upon the world.
So folks, the lyrics are in the chat box. If you want to sing along at home, please do.
When our heart is in a holy place, when our heart is in a holy place, we are blessed with love and amazing grace. When our heart is in a holy place.
When we trust the wisdom in each of us, every color, every creed, every kind, and we see our faces in each other's eyes, well then our heart is in a holy place. When our heart is in a holy place, when our heart is in a holy place, we are blessed with love and amazing grace. When our heart is in a holy place, when we tell our story from deep inside and we listen with a loving mind, when we hear our voices in each other's words, then our heart is in a holy place. When our heart is in a holy place, our heart is in a holy place. We are blessed with love and amazing grace. Our heart is in a holy place. When we share the silence of sacred space and the God of our heart stirs within, and we feel the power of each other's faith, then our heart is in a holy place. When our heart is in a holy place, our heart is in a holy place. We are blessed with love and amazing grace. Our heart is in a holy place. Our heart is in a holy place. When our heart is in a holy place.
Wonderful, Travis. And thank you, Reverend Lora. We're so glad you're here.